لله نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جزيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته اللهم أحينا على سنته وأمتنا على ملته واحشرنا تحت لوائه وأردنا حوضه واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. Brothers and sisters, a hadith in which a command comes that you don't find anything similar to it anywhere in the Quran or in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Very unique. And the hadith is a hadith Qudsi, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, Ya ibadi, inni harramtu al-zulma ala nafsi wa ja'altuhu baynakum muharrama. We know that zulm, injustice and wrongdoing is prohibited for us in the Quran, right and left. But for Allah to start off saying, O my servants, I have made zulm, I have made injustice and wrongdoing forbidden on myself, and I have made it forbidden for you. It's a huge fit. That means zulm is as ominous, as troubling, as serious as it can get. Most of us, when we think of zulm, we think of zulm that we commit against each other. So whenever the issue of injustice comes, everybody remembers somebody who did something wrong to him. But the hadith is pointing us in a different direction. He is telling us he prohibited it on himself. Allah is capable over everything. He can do anything he likes. He doesn't need prompt, he doesn't need help, he doesn't need encouragement, he doesn't need support. But still, why would he, Allah in his majesty, prohibit zulm on himself? It is to tell us this is very, very serious. Another point related, of course, is the fact that when the Quran condemned shirk on the tongue of Prophet or the righteous man Luqman, Luqman says, Ya bunayya, la tushrik billah. Don't commit shirk. Don't associate anything or anyone with Allah. And then he follows, إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. Definitely we understand that the shirk is the worst ever sin anyone could commit. But here is the Quran condemning shirk as a form of zulm. But it is a great and grave injustice. Why? Because in associating anyone with Allah, you are equating someone with Allah, or worse yet, you are giving priority or preference to someone above Allah. So shirk is a grave injustice. But there is one form of injustice that we don't pay attention to, that the Quran makes it so much a grave sin that people who do it, they end up condemned into hellfire despite the trouble and the miseries they have been living in. I want you to pay attention to this one because this is the focus. It's a form of injustice that people commit against themselves that ends up condemning them to hellfire. From the moment of death, they are promised that their fate is hellfire. What kind of zulm is this? Let us read the ayah in Surah An-Nisa, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَوَفَّاهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ ظَالِمِي أَنفُسِهِمْ. As far as those who are taken to death, their souls are being captured by the angels of death. While they have lived wronging themselves. I want you to pay attention one sentence at a time because it builds on each other. So those are people who die wronging themselves. And at the time of death, the angels are going to ask them, قَالُوا فِيمَ كُنْتُمْ. What were you doing? What was busying you from doing what you have to do? What their answer is? Their answer is, كُنَّا مُسْتَضْعَفِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. قَالُوا كُنَّا مُسْتَضْعَفِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. We were helpless, exploited, manipulated, and we couldn't do anything. False claim. False claim. The answer will come from the angels. فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَأْوَاهُمْ جَهَنَّمْ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. They are saying, we were helpless. And they were helpless. They were exploited. They were repressed. They were manipulated. Their money was taken away. Their women were whatever. Their children were killed. And they surrendered to their helplessness. They adapted and adjusted to helplessness. So it became a way of life. So what is their sentence? فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَأْوَاهُمْ جَهَنَّمْ. Those are doomed into Jahannam. وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. It's the worst fate. May Allah protect us all from Jahannam. Then the ayah continues. إِلَّا الْمُسْتَضْعَفِينَ. What? They are saying we are مُسْتَضْعَفِينَ. We are helpless. And the ayah is saying, except those who were truly helpless. So the Quran distinguishes between actual helplessness and surrendering to the concept of helplessness. Accepting helplessness is a huge fit. Accepting manipulation is a huge sin. Think about it. Where has our ummah been for the past several hundred years? Where have we been? Helpless. But is all of our ummah helpless? Does all parts of our ummah suffer from real helplessness, or some parts can get more relief, can help themselves? And this is the difference between true helplessness and accepting fake helplessness as a way of life. When we accept helplessness, We are surrendering to whoever wants to exploit us. Come, our back is yours. Our shoulder is yours. Our bowing is for you. Our prostration is for you. Our submission is to you. As if Allah has not given us the gift of the human dignity, the gift of the human will, the gift of freedom. We all remember the story of the son of Amr ibn al-As, the ruler of Egypt, of all places. That son shielded himself in the power of the position of his dad. His dad was the ruler. So he had a fight with one of the Egyptian Copts, and he whipped him. And the other guy was helpless. This is the son of the ruler. What do you do? But he knew that Umar ibn al-Khattab, the caliph in Medina, would not accept this oppression. So he goes all the way to Medina from Egypt, which is quite a fit in those days. He didn't take a two-hour flight. So he goes all the way. Look at the will. Look at the dignity. Look at self-respect. He is willing to risk his life in the desert to protect his dignity, to reclaim his dignity as a human being. I cannot accept to be enslaved, even if it were the ruler or the son of the ruler. I cannot accept it. So he goes through the desert. Nobody tells us how he crossed, but most probably it is Sinai and the other way through Jordan, all the way to Saudi Arabia, all the way south, a trip that may take you with the fastest beast on land at least a month. A man travels 1 month one way with all the provision he needs for himself and his ride, to submit a complaint and to reclaim his dignity. Goes to Umar ibn al-Khattab. He submits his complaint. Excuse me? Yes, Umar ibn al-Khattab is the Khalifa in Medina. That's where he goes. He doesn't go to Amr, because Amr, in his view, left his son wild. You know how some rulers, their sons are wild? Right? That was one of them. So in any way, so he goes to Umar ibn al-Khattab and submits his complaint. Umar receives him well, he hosts him, and he tells his servants, pay him the cost of the trip, whatever it is. And he calls on Amr and his son to be brought to Medina. So Umar understood that this man is so hurt, and there may be like him others who have not had the chance to come. So he wants to make a lesson and to set a standard. So he calls Amr ibn al-As and his son. They come to Medina, and he asks the son, did you whip this man? He says, yes. Umar gives the whip to the man, and he does not tell him, hit the man who hit you. He tells him, hit the bald head of Amr ibn al-As, whose son attacked you using his power and his position. One may ask, but isn't it in the Quran, وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى, that no soul should carry the burden of another soul? Why doesn't he let him hit the son and that's finished? Because the son could not have dared doing it without leaning on the power of his father. This is how much Islam values the dignity of every single individual. Our collective dignity as an ummah is a gift that Allah has given us like the gift Allah has given everybody else. There are two levels. One is وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ. We have honored the son or the child of Adam. Every child of Adam is dignified. All humans. And then another level, وَلِلَّهِ الْعِزَّةُ وَلِرَسُولِهِ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. The real full dignity given by Allah is finally a gift from Allah to the believers. وَلِلَّهِ الْعِزَّةِ. To Allah belongs all the ultimate dignity. The source of dignity is Allah. Then وَلِرَسُولِهِ. And to his messenger. And then to the believers. So Umar ibn al-Khattab, who did that, is the one that we quote his famous statement. He says, نَحْنُ قَوْمٌ أَعَزَّنَ اللَّهُ بِالْإِسْلَامِ. We are a nation, we are a community that Allah has given our dignity in the form of our Islam. Our Islam is our source for dignity. You have as much dignity as much as you have Islam. فَإِنَ اَعْتَزَزْنَا بِغَيْرِهِ أَذَلَّنَا اللَّهِ. If you seek dignity, protection, and honor in anything else, Allah will put us down and will humiliate us. Back to Surah An-Nisa. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَوَفَّاهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ ظَالِمِي أَنفُسِهِمْ. But they did not say, we wronged ourselves. They said, we were helpless, which means others exploited our helplessness. The ayah answers, فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَأْوَاهُمْ جَهَنَّمْ. Those are going to be sent to Jahannam. وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. It's the worst of fate. Then, إِلَّا الْمُسْتَضْعَفِينَ مِنَ الرِّجَالِ وَالنِّسَاءِ وَالْوِلْدَانِ لَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ حِيلَةً. They have no way out and no way to push back. وَلَا يَهْتَدُونَ سَبِيلًا. They have no path out of the misery of helplessness, repression, oppression, and or wrongdoing and injustice. So the only case you are really excused when you are helpless is when you are, number one, truly helpless. And the definition is you can do nothing. Nothing. Look at, for example, the people in Gaza. Poor people. What can they do? Look at the people in Chechnya. They fought back as much as they could, but they were defeated. They were overpowered by their enemies. So they become helpless. They have done all what they could. Look at the people in Turkestan, East Turkestan in particular, that is occupied by China or grabbed by China. They are truly helpless. A ruthless regime is killing men, women, and children. And those who survive the killing campaigns, they are taken into camps and they are being tortured to leave their deen. Their mosques are being demolished. So in those cases, like Kashmir and many other places, Yemen, you can go on, Iraq, Syria, you can go on. The list is expanding. It's not limited. Do you know where it all starts? It starts with the community at our level. When we talk to each other, helplessness, we are feeding helplessness. But when we talk self-defense and pushing back, then our will be alive, Our dignity will be the flame that we carry forward, and nobody could dare oppress us. This is what Allah tells us in the Quran. Read, if you will, in Surah Al-Anfal, وَأَعِدُّوا لَهُمْ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ وَمِنْ رِبَاطِ الْخَيْلِ. We see our own munafiqeen selling our land and our dignity for free to our enemies, and they are still ruling us. And we don't even talk about defending our own dignity. So why don't they act like pharaohs, all of them? Because we are not worthless. We are not worth it for them. They don't see our value, because we devalue Allah. We devalue Him as a source of support. We relinquish our relationship with Him. He would relinquish us to those who oppress us. So the lesson here is, why would Allah punish a group of people who have been manipulated and exploited for life? It is because they could have helped themselves. You know, for anyone to help you, even if you have fallen in a well, and the well is deep, he can't help you until you lift your hand to catch his. But if you keep your hand tight and keep telling yourself, I can't, you will never can. You will never be able to even help yourself because of what you're telling yourself. I can do nothing. So we say this to ourselves as individuals, as friends. Are you going to be the muslih? No, I'm not going to be the muslih. So who's going to be the muslih? Everybody says, not me, then nobody? Okay. You will live in helplessness. This is a formula that our ummah needed to understand hundreds of years since colonial powers started to set foot in our lands, and since hypocritic regimes took over our nations and our communities. We needed to know this lesson from the beginning. Nobody should enslave nobody else, because we are all created servants of Allah, but for each other we are free agents. And this is what Umar ibn al-Khattab told Amr ibn al-As as the young man was hitting him. He told him, مَتَ اسْتَعْبَدْتُمُ النَّاسِ وَقَدْ وَلَدَتْهُمْ أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ أَحْرَارًا. Since when did you enslave people, a whole community, while their mothers gave them birth as free agents? When did you announce them as your slaves? This is a question that we need to ask ourselves. Since when have we accepted to live as slaves by anyone, local, domestic, or foreign, to manipulate and exploit us? This is not acceptable for any Muslim, not by Allah, not by the Messenger of Allah, not by the mother who gave you birth, not by your father. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us reclaim our dignity and reclaim our freedom that He gave us on birth. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحابته ومن اتبع سنته بإحسان إلى يوم الدين brothers, accepting to be enslaved by anyone or any group or any government or any entity dooms us to hell fire. So you neither have life here nor you have life there. It's the worst thing you could do to yourself. And we have to start with educating ourselves about our dignity that Allah has gifted us at birth. We have to keep talking to our children. Do you know that in the schools here in America, they tell young kids, nobody should force you to do anything you don't want to do. Just to teach them that they have dignity. Even at young age when they cannot make good judgment, they are telling them, don't accept abuse. Don't accept oppression. Even by your own parents. And a child grows up in any of the Muslim countries, unfortunately, to be taught parents can abuse you. Your teacher has the right to abuse you. The policeman has the right to abuse you. How much dignity is left in a human being when he lives abused from birth until he grows up as an old man? How much dignity is left? We need to change that system. It can only be reclaimed by the force of education, awareness, and practice. Teach your children they should never accept slavery. They should never accept manipulation. They should never accept for their money to be stolen, for their opinion to be hushed out, for their position to be ignored. And this is the dignity that Allah wants for us. May Allah help us again to reclaim our dignity and to reclaim our full humanity. Allahumma ahdina fi man hadayt, wa'afina fi man afayt, wa tawallana fi man tawallayt, waqina wasrif anna sharra ma qadayt. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا واجعله الوارث منا واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا إلى النار مصيرنا وإذا أردت بقومنا فتنة فنجنا منها يا مولانا غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ولا مبدلين ولا مغيرين أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فستذكرون ما أقول لكم وأفوض أمري إلى الله إن الله بصير بالعباد وأقم الصلاة.